Would you please stand with me as we begin our service this morning on this Easter Sunday? We're going to sing the chorus to that hymn that was just being played. He lives, he lives.
He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how. I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
Christ is risen.
Let's read together now from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 1 through 4,
this wonderful affirmation of the resurrection of Christ. Let's begin. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. This is the Word of God. Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning. I'm also just astounded when I think of the ladies who came to the tomb early in the morning to anoint Jesus' body with spices, and they saw that the stone had been rolled away. And they looked inside, and they saw a young man sitting there, an angel, and he said to them, "What are you looking for? The Jesus that you're looking for, he is risen." And just the astonishment on their faces as they walked away, just an amazing as we celebrate today. Well, we have a few announcements for you this morning, and we welcome all of you today to this Resurrection Sunday. And if you're sitting on one of the outside aisles there, there are pads of registration slips that if you would take one and just pass it down the aisle so that everybody has a chance to give the registration. Also, you can, if you have a prayer request that you'd like the staff to pray for, we would love to pray for you for any prayer requests that you would like to write down there. Well, this morning, if you're a first time attender here with us, we welcome you, and we have a special gift for you back at the Welcome Center, which is back in the foyer there, and please stop by after the service and pick that up. Also, camping season is coming up really fast on us. And spring is here, but it doesn't look like it today very much, but it is. And we have the Warm Lake Camp registration forms on the table back there in the lobby. So pick one of those up and get ready to get your kids signed up for that. We are having a special celebration today downstairs in the fellowship hall. We're going to be honoring Alice Binford, who has been our church secretary for 22 years. She's retiring, and we want to honor her downstairs today, right after the service. There's not going to be any Sunday school today. And tonight, the Sunday night Bible study at the Scotts will not meet either. Now, the first camp training is Saturday at 1:30, and this is the only one of the two training sessions offered this year, where you'll be able to serve at Warm Lake Camp if you go through this training session. So it's very important that you come. Other events for men and women coming up. On Saturday, April 9th, we have a men's breakfast. It's at 8 o'clock in the fellowship hall. Just a fun time for men, and a good breakfast as well. And also for the ladies, there's a mug and muffin at 10 a.m. in the library that same day. And if you can come to these on April 9th, Would you just mark on your registration slip either if you would RSVP men's breakfast or mug and muffin for the ladies? Thank you very much. Well, we have two missionaries that we have the opportunity to encourage today. And we have letters and envelopes that are already postmarked for them. And the first one today, I would encourage you to encourage Carol Brenton, who is here with us today. And she has received all of her support. The Lord is so faithful to her. And she is going to be leaving to go to Africa in May. And so I'm sure she would appreciate anybody who would like to give her any support in that way also. But the Lord is so good to her, and you can encourage her by sending a note to her, if you would. If you would raise your hand for encouraging her, thank you very much. Our second missionary today is Mike and Thera Anderson, and they have been serving most of their lives to the people on the Sudest Island off the coast of Papua New Guinea. And they have worked translating their languages into the New Testament, and also they're working on a couple exciting new projects. They haven't stopped their ministry. They've gotten into two more projects they've got into. So you can read about that if you take this letter today. Somebody raise your hand for the Andersons. They're right back there. Thank you. Right now, it's a special time for us to share in some baptisms tonight, today.
As you read the New Testament, it's obvious that it was a normal practice in the first century that when someone put their faith in Christ for salvation, they followed that decision with a public demonstration of baptism. It's our conviction that baptism is best expressed in the process of immersion, because the word itself means to fully submerge. It's a word that was used in the Greek language to express the process of dyeing a piece of cloth that's pushed all the way into the dye. And so this morning, we're going to have some candidates coming for baptism. And this process, this act of baptism, is a beautiful illustration of what we're celebrating today on Easter Sunday, that Jesus died for our sins and rose again from the grave. Because as each person goes under the water, they are identifying specifically with the death of Christ. And as they come up out of the water, they are proclaiming the resurrection of Christ. At the same time, each person is also announcing and testifying to the fact that they are dying to their old way of life and coming alive to their new life in Christ. I have the privilege this morning of baptizing three people, and then Lloyd Childs will be baptizing his new adopted daughter. So I'm going to invite Luke and Jessica Tobin to come now and join me in the baptismal. Thank you. I've had a joyful privilege of spending some time with this couple, had the opportunity to do their premarital counseling, to conduct their wedding, and now, actually, there are four of us in the tank because Jessica is pregnant, and so we have a passive person who's being baptized along with Jessica as well. So this is very exciting. I don't recall through all the years of ever baptizing someone who was pregnant, so it's exciting. I have Jessica's testimony I'm going to read for you. I've always had God in my life, but it wasn't until a few years ago that my relationship with Him began to grow. And it wasn't until recently that I truly learned to trust in the Lord. I've made the decision to be baptized because I believe Jesus is my Savior and that He died and paid for my sins. I pray that God will use me to spread His word and His love wherever it may be needed. I look forward to continue building my life and family with God as the foundation.
Jessica, because of your testimony of faith and your desire to be baptized today, it's with great joy as your brother in Christ that I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
And her husband now, Luke Tobin, and I have his testimony as well. I've made the decision to turn my life over to Christ because I believe that he died and paid for my sins so that I may know him and walk with him in paradise. I love God the Father, Jesus his Son, and the Holy Spirit because he knew me and loved me and wanted me before he even created the foundations of the earth. Not just me, but everyone. So I pray that as a born-again Christian, God will use me as a vessel to spread his love everywhere he leads me.
Well, Luke, we've been talking about this for a long time, and it's a special joy for me as your brother in Christ to baptize you this morning in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Now, this next candidate is a very special privilege for me. All of these are a special privilege. She's coming.
One more step. Come and stand right there. Okay. There we go.
We've been doing release time, bringing students over from Wilson School for lunch and a Bible lesson for several years. And it's a joy for us. We have 60 or 70 children coming every week now on Tuesday afternoons, and we bus them over, feed them lunch, share the scriptures and the Lord with them, and then take them back so they can finish their school day. And this is the first time that a student from release time, that being the connection to our church, has made the decision for baptism. And I'd like to read Anna Marie's testimony. Hi, my name is Anna Marie, and I'm almost 8 years old. I'm in the second grade, and my teacher's name is Mrs. Dickens. I would like Jesus to be my Savior, and I would like to be baptized. And I told Anna Marie that I was about her age when I made this decision myself. And you know, Anna Marie, the Lord has been faithful to me as my Savior all these years of my life, just as he will be for you as well.
Cross your arms, hold your nose, huh? Anna Marie, because of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your desire to be baptized today, as your older brother in Christ, it's with great joy that I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Now, we have another special baptism. Lloyd Childs is coming now to baptize his adopted daughter.
Airborne's testimony comes out of 4 days of talking and studying baptism this past week, and so I'd like to read a summary or a distillation of her thoughts. When my mommy and daddy came to get me in Thailand, November and through December last year, I waited so long for them to come. Sometimes I did not think they would come. I was going to the temple with my aunt and with my other grandmother. When my mom and dad came to, it was a stressful time. My family in Thailand were indulging me on a daily basis, I was often confused and in a very bad mood almost daily. In early December, we went by airplane and car to my great-grandfather's house in a village in central Thailand. On December 6, I was in a bad mood. My daddy and mommy heard Jesus say to them, "It is time to talk to Airborne about sin." The three of us got chairs and sat in the back of the main room near the stairs. Papa explained that Jesus forgives sin and wants to come into our life. We prayed together, and Papa taught me how to ask Jesus to come into my life. I did not hear Jesus, but my new parents heard Jesus tell them it was time for this talk. I still do not hear Jesus speak to me, but I know God will not lie to me. He will come into my life if I ask. I asked him. More and more, I want to get to know Jesus. I want to turn my attention to him every day for the rest of my life. When I swim on the swim team, I want to ask Jesus to help me do my best. For my study of piano, English, and math, I need Jesus to help me in everything, just like my parents prayed for everything about my adoption and finally came to get me in Bangkok after 3 years and 7 months. God helps me in whatever I ask. I believe in Jesus, so I want to be baptized, as it says in Acts 8:12. In a book, Jesus in the Spotlight, which I study daily in homeschool, in Awana, and in my class on Sunday, I learn more about following Jesus. I want to follow him every day. I want him to speak to me. I want to hear Jesus guide me for the rest of my life. I have had three beginnings. 11 years ago, I was born in Ratchanavej General Hospital in Pitsanulok, Thailand. On December 6, 2015, when I confessed my sin and asked Jesus into my life, I was adopted into Jesus' family. He loves me, and I love Jesus. And Jesus said to me, "You are no longer a child of the night, but you are children of the light. You are a child of the light of Jesus." And my third beginning was on December 17th last year, when I officially was adopted into my new family to be with my mommy and daddy, who love me and I love them. Right?
Yep.
Amen. Everyone, I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Prabida, Prayesukrit, Prawinyan. Okay.
Well, this is a very special day to spend with my brothers and sisters in Christ, and I just ask right now that you would stand and welcome those around you and to the service today. And I'd also like to welcome our radio audience today, and I just hope that you would receive a special blessing on this Easter Sunday.
All right, would you please remain standing? We are going to begin singing hymn 216, Christ Arose.
Thank you.
Would you please remain standing as we recite together our verse of the month? And it's from actually two verses from Psalm 19, verses 7 and 8. Let's begin. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. Psalms 19, 7 and 8. This is the word of God. You may be seated. Now we're going to receive an offering this morning, and I invite you to participate in that. But if you're a visitor today, this is for our own folks, for those who are a regular part of our family, so we don't want you to feel any obligation about this. Well, this Resurrection Sunday is particularly precious today because Tim Terriberry was promoted to glory on Friday. And I know that Joe has appreciated so much your support and your love and prayers, having so recently sent Jack off to heaven and now her son, Tim. And so thank you for continuing to pray for Joe and her family. And yesterday morning, our dear Lorena was promoted to heaven. And her memorial service is pending. We'll get that word out to you as soon as we have the final details on that. So many people have passed through our church who've been blessed by Lorena Grossenbach. She touched every child who came through the nursery and then from the beginner Sunday school class. All of my children benefited from Lorena's love and care. And so heaven is sweeter and richer today. And the fact of the resurrection and our hope of eternal life is just that much more precious today. Will you please join me as we come before the Lord in prayer? Father, we're hanging all of our hopes on the promises from your word, the assertions and statements that are so plain and clear that Jesus died for our sins and Jesus rose again. And Jesus is at your right hand in this moment, even now, interceding for us as we pray together. Thank you for these lives lived for your glory. Thank you for Tim and for Lorena and for the testimony that their lives bore of their faith and trust in you. And this morning, we give you praise for the way the Lord Jesus is honored in their lives. And we pray comfort for Glenn and his family and for Joe and her family. Father, we also thank you for faithful servants who are proclaiming the living Christ. Thank you for Mike and Thera, and for a lifetime of ministry on the island of Sudest, translating your word so that other people can hear. And now we pray for the project of recording your word so the people can listen to your word being spoken. And as Carol prepares to leave, Father, we pray that you will pour your anointing down upon her as her burden for ministering to the deaf in Kenya will blossom and flourish into many people coming into your kingdom. Thank you for the privilege also of being able to pray for our country today in desperate times. We pray that those who serve us in elected or appointed positions will realize the sacredness of their office, that they are in those positions because you have willed it so, and that they might submit themselves to you. We thank you for your sovereign authority over all these things. We also rejoice in knowing that other churches in our community are proclaiming the word of life. We pray for New Life Bible Fellowship here in Caldwell and Nissa Baptist Church in Nissa. Thank you that these churches are standing along with us in the proclamation of the truth of God's word. We also pray for Pastor Rob Zacklin in Payette, whose life is slipping away on hospice. Thank you for his faithfulness across the years of his life. Now, Father, as we give this morning, we do so with hearts of gratitude and thanksgiving. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Children may now be dismissed for Children's Church.
that Jesus shed for me way back at Calvary, the blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain, and it flows to the lowest valley. That gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. It soothes my doubts and calms my fears, and it drives
just give the benediction and go home after that. That says it all, doesn't it? Would you please come with me to the Gospel of Matthew? It's the first book in the New Testament, the first of four Gospels. We're going to look at the resurrection account as recorded by Matthew, and this follows along with where I've been preaching the last several Sundays, preaching through the Gospel of Matthew, but we're going to skip to the last chapter because it's Easter Sunday. You know, if Jesus rose from the dead, then all the other questions really don't need an answer. Because if Jesus conquered death, then we can trust the rest of the Bible. If Jesus did not rise from the dead, then as Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, people who claim to be followers of him are of all men most miserable. We are the most to be pitied and hopeless if Jesus did not rise from the dead. But on the other hand, the resurrection, the death and bodily resurrection of Christ, are specifically predicted throughout the Old Testament, covered in detail in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, repeatedly mentioned in the book of Acts, and are the basis of the integrity of the rest of the New Testament. including an extensive testimony and explanation, as I just mentioned, in 1 Corinthians 15. Psalm 22 is a historic prediction and prophecy of the death and resurrection of Christ from the pen of King David. In fact, Jesus, on the cross, spoke the words of the opening verse of Psalm 22, those words so familiar and so filled with angst, my God, why have you forsaken me? Isaiah 53 is a specific prediction written hundreds of years before the birth of Christ, which details the redemptive purpose of the life of Jesus and his death and his resurrection. Konrad Adenauer served as the Chancellor of Germany after World War II and was the architect to rebuild Germany into the nation that it is today. In the latest issue of Decision Magazine, Billy Graham shares a personal anecdote. Before Adenauer retired in 1963, he met with Billy Graham for coffee in his office, and after the initial greeting, the Chancellor suddenly turned to Mr. Graham and said, Mr. Graham, what is the most important thing in the world? Before Graham could answer, the Chancellor answered his own question. He said, it is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If Jesus Christ is alive, there is hope for the world. If Jesus Christ is in the grave, then I don't see the slightest glimmer of hope for the world. He went on to say that he believed the resurrection of Christ was one of the best attested facts of history. He said, when I leave office, I intend to spend the rest of my life gathering scientific proof of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He passed away in 1967, strong in his faith until the end of his life. Now, I want to go back to a couple of passages in the New Testament that speak specifically of the resurrection. And you know the story of Peter, cowering in fear, denying that he even knew Jesus on the night that Jesus was arrested. And then a few days later, he's on the streets of Jerusalem proclaiming the resurrection of Christ. It's one of the most powerful examples of the reality of the resurrection. In fact, these are words that Peter spoke to the crowds that gathered on that Sunday. God raised him up, Peter said, loosing the pangs of death because it was not possible for him to be held by it. Let all the house of Israel, therefore, know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. You know the result of this sermon. 3,000 people repented of their sins and were baptized that day. And then in Acts 17, we have this remarkable account of the Apostle Paul visiting Athens, a city that was loaded with idols and temples to idols. There was even an altar erected on one street corner to the unknown God, just in case they'd missed something. And Paul took on the whole town with this message in Acts 17. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent because he has fixed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. Now, it's interesting how people responded. Now they, that is when people in Athens, heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, but others said, we will hear you again about this. Today, in our contemporary time, there is perhaps more evidence than ever before of the reality of the resurrection. And today, there is perhaps as never before more people who scoff and doubt and deny that Jesus rose from the dead. The late Albert Ross, who wrote under the pseudonym Frank Morrison, was an investigative journalist and a skeptic of Christianity. He set out to disprove the Christian faith by showing the resurrection of Christ to be a farce. Upon deeper study, Ross realized that Jesus actually did live and actually did rise from the dead. As a result, He became a follower of Christ, and in 1930, he wrote the book, Who Moved the Stone? A major focus of the book is the initial visit of the women to the tomb on that Sunday. He convincingly shows in the book that the attitudes and behaviors of the people in this story could only be the result of one thing, the genuine bodily resurrection of our Lord and Savior. Several chapters are devoted to three different biblical characters that serve as a great evidence for the resurrection. The first is Peter, as I already mentioned. The second is James, the half-brother of Jesus. James refused to acknowledge the Messiahship of Christ until after the resurrection, and he became the leader of the Jerusalem church. The third person was Saul of Tarsus, a man who was a bitter persecutor of early Christians, and later he became the great missionary statesman of the gospel, as well as the author of 13 books of the New Testament. What happened on the road to Damascus so many years ago that changed this man's life so dramatically? The only logical answer to these questions is that each of these men had an encounter with the risen Christ. No mere hallucination, an actual bodily resurrection from the dead. Let's look at the text now in Matthew 28. Now, after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb, and behold, there was a great earthquake. The time signature of the resurrection is clearly stated by all the gospel writers, and Matthew states it as early Sunday morning after the death of Christ, after Christ's death, as travelers made their way to visit the tomb. Now, it's interesting that this earthquake is mentioned because when Jesus died, there was a great earthquake. 3 days earlier, the earth shook. In fact, one of the gospel writers tells us that tombs of deceased saints opened up, and actually people came out of the tombs. They were at the death of Christ. People rose, were resurrected from the dead. And that temple protective barrier to keep people out of the most holy place in the temple, that curtain that protected the most holy place, was torn from the top to the bottom. An object lesson from heaven indicating that the way was now opened for all people to come into God's presence because of the work of Christ. There was a shuddering of the earth when Christ died, and when Jesus rose from the dead, there was a shuddering of the earth. As the women arrive, the angel rolls back the stone. Let's pick up the text again. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus, who was crucified. He's not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you'll see him. See, I've told you." Now, maybe you wondered, what are these Roman soldiers doing in a graveyard guarding a tomb? Well, in the end of chapter 27, we're told that the religious leaders who were behind the crucifixion went to Pilate and said, "You know, it could happen that someone might try to break into the tomb and steal the body, and then we'll have a big problem because they'll claim that he rose from the dead. And so could you please post some soldiers around the grave?" Is this ironic? Have you ever heard of someone guarding a tomb? I mean, come on. So that's exactly what happened. Pilate agreed to this, and Roman soldiers were dispatched. These were people who were seasoned in matters of execution and certainly burial squads. And so they camp out in the cemetery, as it were, and they're waiting to see what's going to happen. Luke tells us that these women who came to the tomb were women who had come from Galilee. Mary Magdalene, Matthew actually mentions her, from whom the Lord cast out seven demons. Mary, the mother of James the Less, or also known as James the Younger, and also mother of Joseph. Salome, the mother of James and John. And then Luke also mentions Joanna. Now, we know from an earlier text in Luke that Joanna, curiously enough, and I just saw this morning, I don't remember seeing this before, but in Luke chapter 7, Luke mentions that Joanna was the wife of Chuza, Herod's household manager. Isn't that interesting? The gospel had penetrated right into Herod's home, and Susanna was there. Did you notice what the angel said? He tells them not to be afraid. An earthquake has just happened. The drama of the stone being rolled away, and this dramatic angel and terrified Roman soldiers, don't be afraid. Because they were afraid. And then he tells them that Jesus was indeed dead, and we have the witness of an angelic being to the women telling them, yes, Jesus didn't just pass out and crawl into the, you know, be placed carefully into the tomb so that he could kind of revive. No, he was dead, but he has risen and has left the grave. And he invites them to see the empty tomb. And we don't have the details of that here in Matthew, but we know that the women went in and saw the grave clothes decompressed, lying there. And then he instructs them to take the message of the resurrection to the disciples. Now, put yourself in their shoes. I mean, this is overwhelming information that they receive, but they're absorbing it. John makes it clear that while the other women left the area, Mary Magdalene hung around the tomb. And Jesus came to her, the first person who saw the resurrected Christ. She didn't recognize him at first, thought he was the gardener, the caretaker. And Jesus spoke her name, Mary. And she realized it was the Lord. He said, go tell my disciples that you've seen me and to meet me in Galilee. And then Jesus himself also met the other women who were on their way back into the city. We have this account in verses 8 through 10. So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, greetings. And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there you will see me. He personally greets the women as they're returning to the city. And as I mentioned before that, he appeared to Mary Magdalene. The thing that's interesting about these specific witness accounts is that the Gospels were written soon enough after these events that they could have easily been refuted and discounted if it were not true. When Paul wrote his convincing arguments in 1 Corinthians 15 regarding the resurrection of Christ, when Paul wrote that account, he mentions that at one point, Jesus greeted over 500 people at once. That's plenty of witnesses who saw the resurrected Christ, leaving no doubt that Jesus rose bodily from the grave. If it were not so, there would be plenty of examples and opportunities for people to refute the resurrection of Christ. And this was more than an illusion. He presents himself to the women to see him. He allows them to touch him, and he receives worship from them. The senses are involved in this. They hear his voice, they see his person, they touch him, and they worship him. And he also repeats the instructions of the angel, which validates the presence of the angel. We're not meant to understand that the disciples would not see Jesus until they met him in Galilee. Indeed, Jesus met with them that very day in a closed room. And again a week later in a closed room in Jerusalem. And he met with two of his followers as they were walking to Emmaus later that day. We have the witness of the angel. We have the witness of the Lord Jesus himself to his followers. Josh McDowell was born in 1939. He struggled with low self-esteem in his youth. His father was an abusive alcoholic. He himself endured sexual abuse. He became an agnostic. In college, he intended to pursue a legal degree to embark on a political career. In the course of his college studies, he decided to prepare a paper specifically to refute the resurrection of Christ. Instead, McDowell found overwhelming evidence for the person of Christ and professed his faith in Jesus. After finishing college, he became a college speaker in Latin America, where he interacted with Marxist and fascist student groups. Then he returned here to the United States, where he became an itinerant speaker addressing campus groups about the Christian faith. In his books such as Evidence That Demands a Verdict, Volumes 1 and 2, The Resurrection Factor, and He Walked Among Us, McDowell presents a cumulative case of evidence, including archaeological discoveries, manuscripts of the biblical texts, fulfilled prophecies, and the miracle of the resurrection. In More Than a Carpenter, he blended historical argument with legal arguments concerning the direct witness and circumstantial evidences for Jesus' resurrection. In the scripture, we have the witness of an angel, an angelic being dispatched from heaven. We have the witness of the Lord Jesus himself on the day of his resurrection. In our contemporary times, we have the witness of the writer of Who Moved the Stone, Frank Morrison. We have the witness of Josh McDowell, who wrote More Than a Carpenter, Evidence That Demands a Verdict, and other volumes. But there's another very curious witness that Matthew records for us. The Roman guards themselves give personal witness to the chief priests and to the elders. And there's many interesting aspects of this. We'll look at them quickly. Verse 11. While they were going, behold, that is, while the women were going back to Jerusalem, behold, some of the guard went into the city and told the chief priests, notice what Matthew says, all that had taken place. The angel, yes. The earthquake, yes. The stone moved, yes. The empty tomb, yes. These seasoned Roman soldiers went back and gave testimony to the chief priests and the elders regarding the resurrection of Christ. And when they had assembled with the elders and taken counsel, they gave a sufficient sum of money to the soldiers and said, tell people his disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. You know, if you'll believe that, I got a bridge I'll sell you. These guys were under the death penalty if they fell asleep. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we'll satisfy him and keep you out of trouble. So they took the money and did as they were directed. And this story has been spread among the Jews to this day. Now, let's put ourselves in the feet of these Roman soldiers. They're hanging out at a tomb. You know, some people think that graveyards are kind of creepy anyway, especially in the middle of the night. And then this happens. You know, you're responsible. You're part of the detachment that's assigned to this goofy detail to watch over a tomb. And then the unthinkable happens. And we're told that they are scared to death by the resurrection events. It's not likely that seasoned Roman soldiers, very familiar with death squad details, would be frightened by much. But this event was outside any previous experience that they had known. The forcefulness of the language could mean that they actually passed out. Some of them fainted in fright in a cemetery. They reported everything they saw. They reported seeing the angel. They reported seeing the stone moved and the empty tomb. They told all that had taken place. But it was still not enough to influence these hate-filled members of the religious establishment, because Jesus was seen by them as some kind of threat to the establishment. Matthew tells us that they take hush money from their religious leaders. They were paid off. They sold their integrity to spread a lie around the city of Jerusalem. They agree to spread a lie, denying the known facts of the resurrection with the promise of protection. It's interesting how absurd this lie is. As I just mentioned, falling asleep, knowing that it's the death penalty, they would have divided up responsibility for those who would stay awake and those who might catch a nap in the middle of the night. And they knew, and we know, and anyone who's paying attention would have known, that the disciples were scared out of their wits. There's no way they would take on the Roman guards, asleep or not, to try to fight that stone away from the opening and remove the body of Christ. A lie is attractive, but it's a lie only because it's contrary to truth. A statement that's a lie is by definition contrary to the facts. A lie will cast doubt on the truth, but it can never destroy the truth or change the truth. And the lie is attractive because of a fear of the truth. If they were asleep, as the lie insisted, how in the world would they know that it was the disciples who stole the body? There's so many things wrong with this lie. How could the disciples have snuck up on them, rolled back the stone, packed the body of the Lord out, and snuck off into the night, and them knowing that if they were asleep? It's impossible. And can you imagine them waking up just at the moment, and the disciples, afraid as they were, would have panicked, they'd have dropped the body. It's a ridiculous lie. If the lie were true, the disciples could have very easily been rounded up, and the stolen body of the Lord could have been recovered and replaced in the tomb. Even the disciples were unbelieving when they first heard that Jesus rose from the dead. They couldn't absorb it. They couldn't receive it. And Matthew says that this lie gained traction in the Jewish community. Interesting that it continues to gain traction even today. Though the disciples were completely transformed by the resurrection of Christ, they were no longer fearful. They were instead publicly proclaiming the resurrection, and for most of them at the cost of their lives. One more contemporary witness I'd like to mention. We have the witness in the scripture in this passage of the angel of Jesus himself and the inadvertent witness of the Roman soldiers to the unbelieving religious establishment in Jerusalem. We have the witness of Frank Morrison. We have the witness of Josh McDowell. And another one I'll mention, you're probably more familiar with this one, Lee Strobel, who along with the late Frank Morrison is another investigative journalist. He's the best-selling author of The Case for Christ and is celebrating today his 34th Easter as a follower of Christ. He spent his prior life as an atheist. After finding faith many years ago, he remains as convinced as ever in the truth of Jesus' death and resurrection. While still an atheist, it was his background as a journalist for the Chicago Tribune newspaper that prompted Strobel to investigate and conduct extensive research into Christ with the help of religious and historical experts. He originally embarked on the project to discredit the veracity of Christ's resurrection and dissuade his recently converted wife from life as a Christian. But in the end, he was the one who was powerfully converted. In a recent article, this is what he said. For nearly 2 years, I explored the minutiae of the historical data on whether Easter was a myth or a reality. I didn't merely accept the New Testament at face value. I was determined only to consider facts that were well supported historically. As my investigation unfolded, my atheism began to buckle. One of the first pieces of evidence he gathered was actually from another atheist, historian Gerd Ludemann, who declared Jesus' death by crucifixion indisputable. This was supported by a thorough study by A.N. Sherwin White of Oxford, who himself cited ancient eyewitness accounts of the death of Jesus. As more evidence piled up that built the timeline for the events surrounding his death and resurrection, Strobel recounted scholar William Lane Craig's position that it would be unlikely for the story of the empty tomb to explode with no basis, since its location was well known and it could have been verified by supporters of the idea and naysayers alike. It was just simply too public of an event. But even Jesus' opponents said that the tomb was empty, saying that the body was taken, although there was no one who would have a clear motive for doing so. Strobel says this: "We have 9 ancient sources inside and outside the New Testament that confirm the apostles' conviction that they encountered the resurrected Christ. Repeatedly, these sources stood strong when I tried to discredit them. Could these encounters have been hallucinations? No way, experts told me. Hallucinations occur in individual brains, like dreams, yet Jesus appeared to groups of people on 3 different occasions, including 500 at once. In the end, Strobel, a man armed with logic, education, and skepticism, was finally convinced by the overwhelming evidence laid out in front of him, and he completely embraced the truth, not because he was afraid of death or needed a psychological crutch, but because of the facts. Strobel said, I read books by skeptics, but their counter-arguments crumbled under the weight of the historic data. It's no wonder that atheists so often come up short in scholarly debates over the resurrection. In the end, after I had thoroughly investigated the matter, I reached an unexpected conclusion. It would actually take more faith to maintain my atheism than to become a follower of Jesus. The truth of the resurrection of Christ sustains the integrity of the rest of the Bible. And we're reminded that the Bible is God's final truth to us. It contains everything that God intended for us to know by revelation. The Bible proclaims and insists that Jesus is the Son of God, exactly as he claimed. We know from the Scripture, because of the resurrection, that our salvation is complete. In dying on the cross, Jesus paid the penalty for our sin. And he conquered death and hell and rose from the dead. The resurrection proves that the church has been established. This local church is just simply a part of the capital C church, everywhere where believers gather around the world to worship and serve Christ, along with many local churches in our community. The resurrection proves judgment is coming. Jesus died to protect us from the coming judgment of all who refuse to believe. And so it's obvious, it's clear that the death and resurrection of Christ are necessary for our salvation. Without that, as Paul said, we are all people to be considered most miserable, most hopeless. Hebrews 9:22, quoting the Old Testament, says, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. The wages of sin is death. It's necessary for death to occur in order for our sins to be covered. 1 Peter 3:18 says, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the Spirit. And then these wonderful words, a quotation from the book of Joel in the Old Testament, Romans 10:13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. These people this morning who were baptized bore witness of their faith, their acknowledgement that they were sinners who needed a Savior. They put their faith in Christ, and they're trusting only in him for the forgiveness of their sin and the hope of salvation. From this passage that we studied this morning, we see these 3 witnesses: the witness of an angel, the witness of the resurrected Christ himself, and the inadvertent witness, even of these Roman soldiers, of the resurrection of Jesus. We have the witness of three men who set out to disprove the resurrection and the Christian faith: Frank Morrison, Josh McDowell, and Lee Strobel. Josh McDowell and Lee Strobel are still living. You could track them down and speak to them personally about the journey they went through, leaving their atheism and agnosticism behind and putting their faith in the resurrected Christ. Are you on the sidelines, watching to see if Jesus is the real deal, the Son of God, the Savior of the world? Have you made just a courtesy nod toward him? Or do you have the courage to actually check this out for yourself? Are you ready to see if Jesus means what he says? If he's all that he claims to be? If you're ready to put your faith in him, to declare yourself a Christian, having thought this through carefully and considered the witnesses that are before us, to become a follower of Jesus, a disciple of him? In just a moment, I'm going to pray for you. At the end of the service, I'll be available here in the front for a few minutes to meet with you personally, if you'd like to meet with me. I'd love to help you affirm your decision to put your faith in Christ. It's the most reasonable decision you will ever make. Yes, it's based in faith, but the evidence is overwhelming that I can trust what the Bible says. We also have a packet of information available at the Welcome Center if you'd like to stop by there, so you can do some of your own research, and those materials are available for you. Would you pray with me now, please? Father, for that person who's here this morning, struggling and wondering if this is a reasonable decision to put their faith in Christ, feeling the weight of their own shame and guilt because of wrong they've done, I pray, Lord, in this moment they will acknowledge, right where they're seated, that Jesus died for them and he rose victorious over sin and death, and right now sends an invitation to them to be their Savior. In this moment, Lord, give them the will and purpose to pray, Lord Jesus, I need you. Please come into my life. Forgive my sin. Make me the person that you created me to be. I believe that you died and rose from the grave for me. And right now I'm surrendering all the affairs of my life to you. May that deliberate, specific, and personal decision be affirmed in this moment. And we thank you, Father, for this spiritual interaction that you refer to as a second birth, being born into your family. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand with us, please?
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayal, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as he stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned, bowing to the salvation, where your love pours. nation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. See, the stone is rolled away. Behold the empty tomb. Alleluia, God be praised. He's risen from the grave. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, praise and honor unto thee. Praise and honor unto thee. Praise and honor unto thee.
Amen. We all bow down.
Princes and paupers, sons and daughters, kneel at the throne of grace. Losers and winners, saints and sinners, one day we'll see his face, and we'll all will surrender their crowns and worship Jesus. He is the love, unfailing love. He is the love of God. Summer and winter, the mountains and the rivers whisper the Savior's name. Jesus, awesome and holy, a friend to the lonely, forever his love will reign, and will will surrender their crowns and worship Jesus. He is the love, unfailing love. and we'll all bow down. Kings will surrender their crowns and worship Jesus. Worship Jesus. Worship Jesus. He is the love, unfailing love. He is the love. He's the love. And we'll all bow down. Kings will surrender their crowns and worship Jesus. Worship Jesus. Worship.
I don't know how many of you had a chance to see that movie Risen, but it's kind of a neat picture of Christ and his disciples. It's that idea, if you've seen a video of a dad or a mom that's come home from being out on tour for a year with the service or something, and that little kid sees them for the first time, and they're like, is that really them? They're a little nervous, they're a little scared, and then all of a sudden it clicks, and they just can't stop hugging them, can't stop hanging on to them. I think that's that picture when Christ met Mary in the garden. He's like, you got to let go of me. I got some stuff to do, but I'll see you again. But that's our God. He lets us just hang on to him and hold on to him. He's not a God that stands off. He's a God that loves his children. Great is he who's the King of Kings. This one's a fun one. It's kind of a round. We're all going to be together for Great is He. And then the ladies on this side and all the guys, we're going to stay on Great is He. The ladies, after we do that, For the second time, hallelujah, hallelujah, you're going to go with Jasmine. And then at the end, all of us guys, we're going to finish with hallelujah, salvation, and glory. Here we go.
Great is he who's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is wonderful.
Salvation and glory, honor and power, he is wonderful. Hallelujah, salvation and glory, honor and power, he is wonderful.
Last time, sing it out.
Hallelujah, salvation and glory, honor and power, you are wonderful.
We're going to finish with, oh, happy day, because it's slightly a happy day when the disciples saw their risen Christ, and we get to see him one day, too. Happy day.
Great.
greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, you washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, I'll never be the same. Stand in that place, free at last, meeting face to face. I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace, earthly pain finally we'll see. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive.
Invite everybody downstairs to give a big thank you and a hug to Alice after our service here this morning. But thank you so much for joining us to praise and give him the glory this morning. And I hope you have a wonderful day with your family. Praising Jesus. You're dismissed.